Close your eyes. Imagine yourself outer space. It is completely dark, except for the distant glow of our beautiful planet Earth. As you open your eyes, you can see thousands of tiny bright lights orbiting our planet. They are satellites, tools that us Earthlings have put there to enhance our life from above. Satellites have become such an essential part of our daily life that we often forget how much we rely on them to make life run smoothly. They allow us to travel the world without getting lost in the middle of nowhere, most of the time. They observe and protect us by predicting the weather and monitoring climate change. But most importantly, they allow us to connect with each other. By providing internet to the people in the remotest part of the world, even up in the skies when we are flying to our travel destination. Space has been providing us many ways to explore beyond our wildest imagination. Just like in science fiction movies, where fiction has become reality. For instance, let's visit our neighbor, the moon. We are currently building a station around it called the Gateway. And in the near future, we foresee to build a moon village using the resources directly available there and relying on robots that we can either control from Earth or from this future station. This is how much space enables us to achieve. If we come back closer to Earth now, as of now, we count 5,000 satellites around it. But only 40% of them are in operation. Why? Because the rest of them have become space debris. Not only has the number of satellites doubled over the last 3 years, but also the amount of space debris, which constitute 60% of the existing satellites in orbit. More than 10,000 satellites are going to be launched in the next 10 years alone. Yet, there are already 34,000 pieces of debris bigger than 10 centimeters around the Earth. If we add to that the smaller bits, we can count more than 130 million pieces bigger than 1 millimeter. So if we add up the masses, we obtain the Eiffel Tower. It is like having a direct staircase to heaven. It is starting to look like a wrecking yard. If I were an astronaut, somewhere in my dreams, I would be quite scared to go up there. Human missions in space is already quite complicated. Space is quite a hostile environment. But if you also have to dodge bits of debris or end up in a situation like the movie Gravity, where you see a piece strikes the International Space Station and everything going haywire, you can imagine how difficult it might be to perform any kind of operations in space. Besides, it also puts the existing satellites that we use to monitor Earth with in jeopardy. So, what can we do? We still need satellites, but we don't want to add up to the 60% of debris. So, space professionals like me are imagining new kinds of missions. These missions need to be smarter and innovative in order to first counteract the growing populations of satellites and better manage the future in space. Doesn't this look a bit familiar? It seems like we are reproducing the same mistakes that we have done on Earth, where we have done a lot of things very quickly without thinking too much about the consequences, and now we are trying to reverse back to a more sustainable lifestyle. What could be the solution in space? We have to do on-orbit servicing. It is a way of directly managing satellites that are already in orbit. A satellite, at the end of its life, it's either going to die in a graveyard orbit. This is the case for geostationary satellites, called GEO in short, that are at 36,000 kilometers in altitude, or they're either going to disintegrate themselves as they enter the atmosphere. This is the case for low Earth orbit satellites that are between a few hundred and 1,000 kilometers. A GEO satellite is designed to last between 10 to 15 years. But if something happens, there's no way we can send an astronaut to repair it. First, it is very expensive, and second, also very dangerous. Besides, it will require more than 1,000 astronauts like Thomas Pesquet or Samantha Cristoforetti to perform these operations. We cannot really ask them that now, can we? So what else can we do? Usually, if something goes wrong, we call customer service. Well, we are not so far. We would need a special vehicle called a servicer. It's a super space vehicle with robotic arm, various tools, gripper. First, it will inspect the environment of the client satellite, then perform a rendezvous to capture the spacecraft, and execute the required operations. It can be capturing it to help with its attitude, what we call station keeping. Could be refueling, repairing, or upgrading. A satellite at the end of its life, as I said, for a geosatellite, they are going into a graveyard orbit. So the servicer can also help the satellites reaching their end of life by putting them in a graveyard orbit, or for the lower satellite's orbit, putting them back towards the Earth for them to disintegrate. All this helps us become more sustainable in space. First, if you attend to the satellite in orbit and extend their lifetime, you're delaying sending up a new spacecraft and to fully replace it in the future. And second, if you attend to the satellites that are reaching their end of life, you have less satellite that becomes uncontrolled debris. Thus, as a result, we become more sustainable. But in order to enable these advanced operations in space, could be refueling or upgrading, you need to prepare your satellites from now on with specific interfaces, like grapple fixture or interfaces that would require for refueling or upgrading. It is a bit more complex to perform it on an unprepared spacecraft. Still feasible, but more complex. Us humans always want to do bigger and better things. We like to run ambitious missions at an ever faster pace, but it's not necessarily in the most well thought out way, and reversing back is not always an option. We have entered a new era of space system, with an easier access to space, and where several mega constellations are foreseen to be launched to tackle the growing internet needs on Earth. So we are compelled to innovate, invent new technologies, and devise the smartest of missions to follow this trend. Or should I say, keep up as much as we can with this trend. This is the bright side of things, because in the end, we progress on amazing technology that will also be useful and applicable for future space exploration and for the benefit of humankind. Nonetheless, as we look forward developing servicing missions, it allows us to take a step back, think, and be smarter about the way we exploit outer space to create a sustainable environment, following the path on what we are trying to do on Earth. After all, everything we do up there is for the benefit of us down here. So it's in all our interest to get it right. This contributes to life on Earth, to space for life. Thank you. Merci.